25. As you do that, tell you a little bit of what's going on in the Olive Tree Ministry and what we're doing. I started a series on taking everyone to Israel in preparation. This is about 2 years ago, in preparation of a trip to Israel I was going to lead. And of course, about four once a month classes into it, COVID hit, and so we paused and we went through to Zoom. Because I had a lot of people that were asking, well, can we get in on this virtual trip? So we're on file number 21. It's always the third Friday of every month. And if you have an internet and you have an email account, you need to email me that you're interested. And for a one-time gift of $4,000, no, I'm just joking. It's free. I don't like to say that too often. Jewish ministry, you understand. But it's free. We've never charged, nor are you talk money. But we'll be dealing with, in December, where everybody goes to Israel. I've led 14 trips to Israel. And everybody always goes, the one thing they always discuss is it the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, where Christ was crucified and buried, or was it Gordon's tomb? And what's called Gordon's tomb. And so Charles Gordon was a archaeologist, general, British general. But anyway, so we'll be dealing with that. This is the big one. The third Friday, I think it's December 17th, I want to say. So it's before Christmas. It starts at 7 o'clock Central Time. So that means it's 8 o'clock here in Ohio. And if you're interested, like I said, you email. We send you the notes and the Zoom invitation if you have interested. What's neat about this series is that we're beginning to 32, and it will become a class at Norris Bible Baptist Seminary when I teach there. It will become a master's class, and then at Brother Isabel's Bible, Texas Baptist Bible College, and they're going to use it for them as well. And then we have some missionaries. We have pastors on the Zoom call a lot of times, and one missionary, Brother Tom Gilmer, has asked for it to be translated into Portuguese. And so I won't tell the whole story, but Dr. Don Leaf, longtime veteran missionary to Brazil, is translating it. And we're excited about that, to see it also be used there in Brazil. And then it's also being translated into Spanish by a longtime veteran missionary, Leslie Prati, Honduras. So we're excited about that, to see it translated. It's a series dealing with Israel. You can even go on my website. We have the last 15 files are there, and you're welcome. Again, you go on my website, it's as MP4, I think they call it, and you can listen to it, and hopefully be a blessing to you, especially if you never got to go to Israel. I spend more time, you learn more on this than you ever learn going to Israel, because you don't have the time to teach them properly, because you want to see everything, and that's normal. So anyway, we're in Matthew chapter 25. Also, tonight I'll have some of the books I have here if you're interested, and Lord's blessed us with a number of books we've written, and we use that money for scholarships to teach students, Bible college students, to have a burden for Israel and Jewish people. So we're in Matthew chapter 25. Would you do me a favor? Would you stand for the reading of God's word? It's not just any book. This is the book of the ages. Amen?
Amen.
And just like in Nehemiah 8, Ezra's on a platform, I'm on a platform, from a pulpit of wood, so am I. Now, he had six guys on the right, seven on the left. That's because he was going to speak Hebrew, and they were going to have to translate it to another language. And so hopefully my English will be good enough. Hopefully. We're in Matthew chapter 25, a very well-known story, the Olivet Discourse. It says, "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened to 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, 'Behold, the bridegroom cometh! Go you out to meet him.' And all those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, 'Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out.' And the foolish said unto the wise, 'Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out.'" Read it twice. "But the wise answered, saying, 'Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves.' And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgin, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he answered and said, 'Verily I say unto you, I know ye not. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh.'" Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, we pray that they catch the vision of what we're trying to preach here. Catch the vision of what this church is seeking to do. That the shortness of the hour, that we need to be ready and prepared so that we meet him in the air. Impact with the message. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. You may be seated. Prophecy is something back in the 70s was big. Late Great Planet Earth, Hal Lindsey. There were a number of books that came out. Many people were saved with many of those prophecy conferences. I remember even when I was first saved, and the church I attended was a Southern Baptist church. They had prophecy conferences. Today we hardly hear about it, yet we're in right now the throes of the end times of the shortness of the hour. The purpose of prophecy is to help us to get prepared, to get ready. The purpose of prophecy, listen to this, is to bring comfort. 1 Thessalonians 4:17, you know the verse. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's the rapture. That's what we're getting people prepared, getting them saved. But what else is it? What about now, preacher? What about now, Lord? We're going through a difficult time. I'm scared of COVID. I'm scared of what's... Our world is changing. Technology is manifesting itself so much faster. I'm left behind. I'm nervous. I'm scared. I'm not even sure I can come to church. I got to watch it on the internet because of all the problems. Verse 18 tells us of that 1 Thessalonians 4, the rapture that I just talked about, tells us its purpose. Where it says, wherefore, comfort. Comfort one another with these words. Boy, what our world today needs is comfort. Not comfort that false comfort of the shot may or may not work, or comfort that your money may or last through retirement. That's not comfort. Comfort, know that you're in God's hand and under God's control. God's still in charge.
Amen.
And what we're seeing today, all the pandemic, and we talked about this earlier, but some of y'all were not there, so just kind of mention it. The purpose of the pandemic, people are ready and open to the gospel. It's not an issue of the other stuff. To keep your focus on what we're called to do, and that is to reach the lost. God used in prophecy several different things that were normal things that happen in daily lives. In Sunday school, we talked about the birth pains that a woman goes through. And it was illustrated not of just salvation, as you must be born again, but also the birth pains that God's going to use in the end times to be that revival in the end time during that tribulation time where God pours out his wrath upon the world. God used something as simple as what a woman goes through because of that came happen because of the judgment in Genesis 3. Now, this morning, we're going to speak on a Jewish marriage, a typical marriage in that time frame, how God used that to give a illustration or a time frame of what prophecy looks like. When we go to Israel, we always like to go to Western Wall and go there on the third day, because a lot of marriages take place on the third day. Now, why the third day? Remember Jesus, when he turned water into wine? It was the third day. Well, why the third day? Well, it's the third day because the rabbis in Genesis, when it says of the third day, if you look up the scriptures, it said it was good twice. So if you want a good marriage, you get married on Tuesday. And I told that to a lady at a church up in Portland, and she sent me back a note saying that was so wonderful. So I went to study what you said, and sure enough, it's good twice there in the third day. But I noticed the second day, she says, I think I found the answer why Mondays are always a bad day. And the reason why is, when you look at the second day in creation, it never says it was good. So that's why Monday's a bad day. That's a joke, folks. Because what does marriage and a third day of God saying good have anything to do with each other? Nothing. But the rabbis, they call it stringing pearls. You take a pearl Bible verse, you take another verse, and you pull it together, and that's called stringing pearls. So, joking over why Monday's a bad day, not saying good. But the Jewish marriage, picture and prophecy, God used that to illustrate the end times. Jeremiah 31 is a verse of scriptures where God speaks to Israel. And he said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. That new covenant is the New Testament.
Amen.
But wait a second. It says it was to the house of Israel and the house of who? Judah. Who's from the house of Israel and the house of Judah besides me? Well, how did you get in? That's what the new covenant was given. Romans 11 tells us you were grafted in. This is why you had to be grafted in. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand Continue reading verse 32, to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant break. Although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. Now wait a second. Maybe you're confused. God said he was a husband to Israel. What does that make Israel? God's the husband, then there's only one other choice. The wife. Wait a second, I thought we were the bride of Christ. I thought we as believers in Jesus are the bride of Christ. Does God have more than one wife? Of course not. What it's speaking of here is a relationship. We don't marry Christ. We don't wear, like the Catholics, they wear the nuns wear a wedding garment. And the men can't get married, women can't get married because they're married to Christ. It's speaking of a relationship. How many times have you heard your preacher say, Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. And so this covenant that God made with Israel as the wife, this wedding contract God used to connect a wedding ceremony to the end times. Typical wedding contract was always back in the Old Testament, even New Testament, was arranged by the parents. You remember the story of Isaac marrying Rebekah in Genesis 24. Isaac was 40, and Abraham sent his eldest servant, probably Eliezer, to find a wife for Isaac. And God showed Isaac who he was to marry, and the servant asked Bethuel for a hand. Despite the misgiving, remember, Rebekah says, has the final word and says, I'll go with him. I'll marry him. If you've ever seen Fiddler on the Roof, the story of Fiddler on the Roof, it was just on TV, I think I heard the other day. But many of you all have seen it. You remember the story where Tevye is saying to his wife, the first time I saw you was on our wedding day. I was scared, I was shy, so was I. So my mother and my father said that we learned to love each other. So Tevye, do you love me? And so the wedding contract being arranged, now we don't do that today. I don't think our children would like that much. But sometimes it could be worse than what's going on, what is actually going on. But it was to fulfill the Abrahamic covenant. It was to fulfill what God had told Israel that they were due. Just like today, a wedding contract in the Old and New Testament was like something drawn up in real estate. I know it doesn't sound very romantic, but you know when you buy something, you have rules of the waiting period. In other words, if someone wants to buy this building, they can't move in tomorrow because your building's not yet ready. So in a case of there with Isaac, she had to leave immediately. And the New Testament is our contract based on that Jeremiah 31 passage. So there had to be a contract, and the Bible is our contract. The Word of God, we're pretty open as Christians. We don't have a lot of books in other languages. We have just one. It's the Bible. And so the wedding contract is all we have. The second point of the Jewish marriage was there was a price. The prospective groom was expected to pay the bride's father. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 7 as we kind of go through this a little bit. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. A lot of times I have this on PowerPoint, and so you don't have to take the time. But 1 Corinthians chapter 7, the Bible speaks of you as a believer, that you are, in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 23, says you are bought with a price. Be not servants of men. You're bought with a price. You're not an individual. You're not, God has paid for you. You're bought completely. You're his servant. In the Old New Testament, it talks about a bond servant a lot of times. A bond servant was a servant who no longer was forced to work for his master. He purposely and through his own will says, I will serve you the rest of my life. Jacob, you remember the story, as we continue that story, worked 7 years for Laban to marry Rachel. It showed the extent of his love. We call that earnest money. Years ago, I had a couple, I was teaching in a Sunday school class, and I had a couple come up to me and ask about if I would marry them. And I said, sure, I'd be glad to. About a week before the marriage, the young man came up to me and said, well, Brother Sabalowski, what do you charge? And so my father-in-law, Brother Spencer, always said this, so I said as well. I said, well, the charge is pay me whatever you think she's worth. And based on what he paid, he didn't think she was worth a whole lot. But anyhow, Jesus paid the price as a final sacrifice. Salvation's not free. It was paid for, lock, stock, and barrel, through Christ in that final sacrifice with his death and shed blood. When we read that 1 Corinthians 7 passage that says that you're bought with a price, be not be servants of men, is given in the relationship of a married couple. When you understand that when you got saved, when you put your faith and trust in him, you're now, in a sense, in a relationship with God. And there's no closer relationship on earth than a marriage between a man and a woman. And words mean things. And so in that same way, a marriage between a man and a woman, so our marriage with Christ in a sense of a relationship. Now, how did the bride show that she accepted the contract? In that time and place, they would pick up the cup and drink from it. It formally establishes the bride's answer to the proposal. It was her to answer. When you partake of the Lord's Supper, as your church as often as you do the Lord's Supper, when you pick up the cup, you're agreeing to the contract. What contract? This one? You're agreeing to the contract that through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, I have eternal life. And because of that, I'm agreeing with the contract and I'm drinking from it. Jesus said in Matthew 26, and he took the cup and gave thanks and gave him, saying, drink ye all this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. The old covenant was established by the blood of animals, with Moses, the blood of the covenant. But the new covenant is established by the blood of Christ, the blood of the New Testament. And by the way, the Lord's Supper was given in the context of a local, visible church. Not some universal, invisible type thing. Amen. So we have the wedding contract, that's the Bible. We have the price of this contract, that's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so now we get to the departure, Jesus' resurrection. The groom and the bride return home, typically in marriage, after the groom had been betrothed, a bride has been betrothed to the groom, they then leave to go back to their prospective homes. John chapter 14, one of my favorite chapters of the Bible. Jesus was there, and he was saying they were all worried about Jesus. They were all scared. You remember at Caesarea Philippi, he had said to them, I'm going to Jerusalem to die. And what was Peter's reaction? Oh, may it not be so. And Jesus said, get thee behind me. And so the rest of the time, the disciples are worried. What's going to happen to us? They're grumbling. They're complaining. They're going, well, if he leaves, what are we going to do? And so they go into the upper room. They're still complaining. In John chapter 14, Jesus puts them at ease. He said, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive to myself that where I am, there ye may be also. And so this departure, Jesus, there in John 14, he says, I go to prepare a place for you. I get a little upset sometimes because people will say, well, you know, preacher, I've been hearing that the Lord was going to return any moment. I've been hearing that for 30 years, 40 years. And I always say, you know what that means, don't you? We're 30, 40 years closer.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
And time is short. Typically in that Jewish marriage, when they're betrothed, the groom would say, I go and prepare a place for you. And he would go back to his father's house and he would begin building a bridal chamber, a little mansion, so to speak. And people being people, young men being young men, I can let my imagination wander a little bit. I can picture that young man building, I stay by the mic, sorry. I can see him building this building. And his bride until that building is finished. And so he's not building that building like you're building yours, at least I hope not. Because when he needs three nails, he's putting in one, that'll do. I'll worry about it later. And he's putting it together very quickly. I can imagine the father just seeing it, not saying anything for a few months. And then he gets it, I can see him coming home saying, son, how's that building, your bridal chamber's going? Oh, I can see that young man, he wants to get his bride. He can't get his bride until he's got that building built. So I can just picture in my mind, oh, dad, it's going up quick. I mean, it's flying. And he said, well, let's go out and look at this building you're building. And I can see him walking around that bridal chambers, seeing the weak spots. And then he takes his foot and kicks that one spot, and down it goes. And I can see the shame and upset, the son and the dad saying, you were taught better. He said, you need to do it right. She deserves it to be right. And so the building that mansion, he can't go get his bride till that time. Remember in the Bible, Joseph thought Mary, his spouse, betrothed, had been unfaithful and thought to put her away. See, only the father of the groom would tell when it would happen, when he could go get his bride. It's not that the son didn't know, it's just that it's the job of the father to say when it's ready. Scripture says in Matthew 24, but that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. So in that point here of departure, we continue. We've told you what the groom is doing. So what's the bride doing? The bride is spending her time gathering her trousseau, getting her oil lamp ready to travel at night. Her friends would come over to help. When she went out, she would go with a veil over because they had COVID back then. They had a veil back then to show that she was keeping faith. Well, she was pure. She would wait at home for her bridegroom, not knowing when he would come. She was consecrated. She was what we call set apart. She's a lady in waiting. You're not your own, for you are bought with a price, 1 Corinthians says. Only the bridegroom's father gave that time. So now we have the next point. We had the wedding contract, the Bible. We had the price. Jesus paid for it. We had the departure. As Jesus left, and now we have the snatching of the way. Snatching away. Once the Father gives the approval, the groom goes to get his bride. 1 Thessalonians 4, we've already talked about this, but I want to point out something of this great rapture verse. For the Lord himself shall descend with heaven with a shout. This shout is for the believers. This shout is the rapture. This is where we meet Christ in the air with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God. The trumpet that's going to come is to bring Israel, make Aliyah back, Jews make Aliyah back to Israel. And so this great rapture verse is speaking of that snatching away. Notice the point, how they did Jewish marriage back then. The father has said, okay, son, go get your bride. He would go typically at midnight, and he would get there and get close. And when he got close, the best man would yell out, behold, the bridegroom cometh! And just like that, he would go up and snatch her. Years ago, I had a lady ask me to write her wedding. She wanted a Jewish marriage wedding style, and we did. And when they got close to the piano, they were up in the balcony. They had to shout. Lights went out. Got their bride. And they came back with the wicks, with carrying a light and wicks. Scared me to death. I can just see someone dropping one of those lamps that were lit and burning the whole church down. And so I only had just enough for the last 5 minutes, as small as we could. And I had someone watching each step. And then someone in the front making sure they got each one, because each side had it. Scared me to death. I was praying they wouldn't drop it. Only those whose lamps were filled with oil can go with the bride. When we look at the Matthew 25 that we read, when we understand what it's teaching, five came ready with the bride, five did not. When the cry arose, the five lacking oil had to go by. Too late, the groom comes, they miss it, and take her to the bridal chambers and shuts the door. And then says, I knew you not. The first of all, we need to make sure you understand in here in Matthew 25, who's missing? Matthew 25, who is the most typically in a marriage today? Who is everybody looking at? It's not the groom. He comes from the side, typically. I'll never forget my father-in-law saying, there was a window, and there was. He said, you can still get out and run away. But when we came out, no one was paying attention. It's not till the wedding march hit. And who comes out? The bride. The whole focus of the wedding is the bride. Except this one. In Matthew 25, the bride is not mentioned one bit. The purpose of Matthew 25 is to tell us who are believers in Christ and who are not. The five foolish virgins didn't prepare. They had the look. They had the look of spirituality. We have today, everybody's spiritual about something. They have all the platitudes. They had the best lamp money could buy. They had everything. It looks like they had power, prestige, and knowledge, but they had no oil. They did not have the Holy Spirit. In other words, they were not saved. But they had the look of spirituality. They had the actions of spirituality. But they didn't have Holy Spirit. They didn't have Christ. Those lamps represent the Jewish leaders. They represent the tabernacle, the temple that was there. It lacked the oil. Bad theology caused them to do bad things. They had only a form of godliness, that lamp. See, very simply put, it's not how spiritual you think you may or may not be. It's not how you think how good you are. And most of us think of ourselves as good people. We're the Americans. We wear the white hat. I mean, surely we will be going to heaven. A lot of times based on our nationality, Jewish people did that. Are we now of Abraham's seed? They would say to John the Baptist and Jesus. They looked at their nationality. We kind of laugh at that. But we have today many, many people who will split hell wide open because they said, well, my mom and dad, that's what they did. They did. Good enough for me. Only those who know Christ, had a personal relationship with him, would be saved. Raised in an Orthodox Jewish home. My time's gone and I'm just getting into it. My testimony, very simply, as a preacher told it very quickly, but very simply, I was a Jew. I went to the synagogue. I was a good person. I had no interest in spiritual things. I had no interest in studying the Bible. I didn't go to church, most definitely. I went to the synagogue. There's nothing spiritual about that. But when the Holy Spirit whispers in your heart your need for salvation, at Nikki Cruz Revival, I got saved. And when I got saved, I knew I had to learn more about my Savior, and I thirst after studying God's Word. Do you thirst after God's Word? We have a lot of people carry Bibles to church. They carry them to church, and they go home and sit them down on the table, and they know right where it's going to be the next week when they go to church. The snatching away, the Jewish marriage, the cry, the shout is for the believers. And then the next step, you've got the wedding contract, you've got the price, Christ paid for it, you got the departure, John 14, and then you had the snatching away of his bride, the church, you and I, believers. And then we have point five, the bridal chamber. That was what he was building. The couple would stay in their bridal chamber on their wedding. See, it's a little different. When you got married, did you send out a reservation? Did you tell everybody the day, the place, and the hour? Sure. They wouldn't know when to come. That's how we do in today in our world. But the Jewish marriage, the snatch away, they didn't know when it was going to take place. There was no day, hour, or place. So is it true in the end times. The bridal chamber, John chapter 3, verse 28. Ye yourselves bear me witness that I, speaking of John the Baptist, said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice, this is my joy fulfilled. Now what happens after a wedding? Today, everybody knows, everybody else goes into the room and gets very hungry as they spend 2-3 hours taking pictures. That's the way it's done today. But that's not the way it was done in old New Testament times. They would go, and they, after the wedding, they got their bride at night. They would walk together, and their entourage and lights, because there was no streets, there were wild animals, there were bad people around, so they were there for protection. They went into the bridal chamber, and when they did that, they would shut the door, and the best man, I never liked that term, because I was the best man at the wedding. I got the best girl and all that, but the second one, he would stand by the door in the old New Testament time period, and once the marriage is consummated, he would announce the wedding is complete, and a couple would stay in their bridal chambers for 7 days, and during that week, the people would celebrate the wedding. And sometimes a host would run out of wine at the ceremony, as we saw happen in John chapter 2. Now we, as pre-tribulationists, we see that when we're raptured up to meet him in the air, we're going to be up there at the wedding supper, and we're there for 7 years while God pours out his wrath on the world. So we now have point six in the marriage supper. The couple emerges from the room, husband and wife. Let us be glad and rejoice, Revelation 19 says, and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come. And his wife, that's you as a believer in Christ, you were raptured out, had made herself ready. And to her was garments, to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen. Now let me get you to see and understand this. What you're going to wear in heaven is based on your works here on earth. Now don't think what I didn't say. I didn't say you work for salvation. That's no. It's always by grace, always by faith. Not of works, lest any man should boast. But what you do here on earth has consequences, and you're going to be granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for listen, the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. You're righteous. You're going to be clothed with your righteousness. Some of y'all might be half naked. If you're not serving God today, if you're not trying to be impactful with people, you're going to be awful embarrassed when everybody's given all these talents, and they're giving these talents to Christ, and you're not going to have but one. I don't know about you, but I love Christ. He died for me. I want to give him all the talents I can get, the crowns, and give it to him and lay it at his feet. The couple emerges from that 7 days as husband and wife. They depart to their own home, which was prepared by the groom. And that's going to be that time on earth during the millennial kingdom. We're going to rule and reign with him. But notice now, we're perfect. Our sins were forgiven at the cross. Our bad works were burned up at the judgment seat of Christ. And now we're presented to the Lamb as a fitting wife. Most of us men will say we married up, would we not? We would say that we married our wives that are much better than who we are. And we were blessed to marry someone that we did. The Lord give to us. In the same way, we're not worthy to be the bride. But our sins were forgiven at the cross. And by the way, that's so important. People struggle, Christians struggle with past sins. We are defeated because Satan uses that past sins. I don't know about you, but I get beat up all the time. Satan will bring up a memory of something where I did something wrong. And I'll say, look what you did. And I'll struggle with that. We have to understand our sins were forgiven at the cross when we put our faith and trust. Right. We're not defeated. We win. Amen. The old story, I read the back of the book, and we won. And our bad deeds, they're going to be burned up at that judgment seat. And the good news is, we're a befitting bride in that we've been made prepared properly. So closing quickly, we have a contract. Jeremiah 31, the Bible. Jesus paid that sacrifice. As the Old Testament sacrifices required, Jesus is that final sacrifice, his death on the cross. Jesus poured the cup at the Lord's Supper and said, drink ye all in remembrance of me. He departed at the resurrection to his Father's place. He said he would build a place for his bride. That's you and me if you're a believer in Christ. As we are staying pure, separated as we serve the Lord here. When the bride least expects it, she's going to be snatched up by the groom at the rapture, at the shout. That's the Feast of Trumpets, the shouts. The consummation of the marriage, the honeymoon, during that 7 years that we're in, with Christ, and that 7 years, that 7 years are happening here on earth, that's when the marriage supper and our bad deeds are burned away. And then we return back to earth as the fitting bride. Only if you've accepted Christ as Savior will you meet him in the air at the rapture. Some years ago, a church called me up, asked me to come speak. They had a church member, her husband was Jewish, and wasn't a believer. He was getting up in age. And so they wanted me to speak with him, and I did. And he says, I don't know about hell. I just don't know about this, this man said to me. He was in his 80s. And so I took him to Daniel 12. And the Bible says in Daniel 12, 2 and 3, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. You're sleeping in dust, that means you're dead. Shall awake. Some to everlasting life, that's heaven, that's with Christ as a believer when you're raptured up. But the others in some to shame and everlasting contempt. That's the great white throne of judgment. Can I say something quickly about the great white throne of judgment? Only a lost will be there. But if you look at the next chapter, chapter 21, it speaks of us who are there. The Bible says God will wipe away our tears. Why are we crying? Why are we crying? Because at that great white throne of judgment, we're the lost, and we'll know the lost that bound for eternal hell. I'm going to see my dad and mom and my brother. And you're going to see loved ones as well that never came to Christ. Of course, the good news there is God wipes away our tears. God himself will wipe away our tears. But Daniel 12:3 continues, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. And they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Wow, Daniel 12 is right there. When you are able to bring others to see them, that they see the need for a Savior. And that's what it means by turning many to righteousness. Because I can't become righteous. You can't become righteous. Romans 7 very clearly says, Paul was saying, wretched man am I. I do right. I want to do right. I do wrong. This was a believer. But he closes with, thank God for Jesus who saved my soul. Turn many to righteousness. So your wedding invitation looks like this. The Father requests the honor of your presence at the marriage of the Son, Jesus Christ, the bride, his church. Time when least expected. Place in the air. The marriage supper of the Lamb following the ceremony, please RSVP by calling on Jesus for salvation with the head bowed and your eyes closed. This is something you don't want to be left behind. Are you born again? Jesus, the Bible uses a Jewish marriage to picture how prophecy was going to play out. It starts with a contract. We need the Bible. Have you read the Bible? Have you put your faith and trust in Christ through reading of the Word of God? Jesus paid that price for you and I. If you're not sure of your salvation, when you say, Brother Phil, would you raise your hand and say, Brother Phil, would you pray for me? No one's looking. There was someone not sure of salvation. Would you raise your hand and say, Brother Phil, I'm not sure I've done that. Come to the church. Maybe I'm like a little bit foolish. I have a nice lamp, but just don't have the power of the Holy Spirit. Let me talk to you as believers. This is the impact. This is the impact. Turning others to righteousness. Getting the gospel to the lost. Nothing new here. You've heard your pastor say it. The question is, are you doing it? Our gracious Heavenly Father, maybe at the invitation, some would say, when someone would say, I need to be a better witness. I need to be more outward with other people, telling my neighbors and friends about Christ. Lord, impact me this morning. And I'll be that testimony to tell others about the cause of Christ. Impact the people. In Jesus' name I pray and with thanksgiving. Amen. As people stand, as the pastor comes, won't you come?
Let's take our hymn book and turn to page 278. And we're going to sing a verse or two of invitation. This is your time of response, that you could respond to the message that was preached. If you're in the building this morning and you've never accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, there is an invitation for you to come. Allow us to take the Word of God and show you how that you can know for sure that heaven is your home. This morning, if you have doubts and concerns, then I would urge you, plead with you, and even beg you to come this morning to accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. So, preacher, what does that look like? It looks like you recognizing that you are a sinner. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one.